Welcome everyone to another edition of Play It Through, and on this edition it's Day Dreamin Davey, brought to us by Hal Laboratories and Sculptured Software. Day Dreamin Davey is an action-adventure game featuring the main character of Davey, a school student who daydreams that his adventures in school are much more than they actually are, having him travel back to the Middle Ages and the Wild West and several other locations throughout each in order to solve different problems that are going on in his regular school day. The game features many different levels, featuring a lot of cryptic ideas for you to figure out and be able to advance through the next stage. Usually you'll have to find a different item and then get to a different location, sometimes taking out a boss, in order to move on to the next stage. Due to its cryptic nature and pretty poor hit detection at times, Daydreaming Davey is far from a dream. So here we go with Daydreaming Davey for the NES. When we start the game, we introduce to our main character, Davey, and the first scenario has the bully trying to steal his pencil. Hey! The first level of the game takes place in the Middle Ages, and right away you'll be next to a rock with no idea really how to get past. You'll learn quickly though, you have to press A and B together in order to jump over the rocks. The jump mechanic works relatively well, and there's a few different attacks you can also do with the jump attack depending upon what items you have selected. You can see at the bottom of the screen is your health bar, as well as your A and B items, which you can actually interchange with many different things in your inventory. Each area or world you explore has different types of items that you'll be using, such as like the lance here, but you may be using a whip in the Wild West, or in the ancient Rome-like areas you'll be having a bow and arrow. There's several other items you can pick up besides main key items, such as the hourglass, which will freeze all enemies in place for a period of time. A lot of times in the game, I find it best to just run past a lot of enemies if I can. Enemies will disappear and reappear quickly when they're going through the trees nearby here, which can be a little disorienting. Down here in the lower right corner, we find our first major item of the game, the sword, and we need this sword in order to take out the first boss of the game. Most levels are very similar to this, and all of the Middle Age levels start off in this particular map, with different locations that we have to go to, sometimes branching off to farther parts of the map that we have to go to via bridge, but those come up later on in the game. You revisit the areas many different times throughout the game, so while there is a lot of levels, there's only a few locations. The cool thing though is you get to visit different areas of the levels each time you revisit. Moving Davey around can be a pain when trying to get through especially narrow areas. You'll try to get in between the level itself and maybe the bottom or a rock and end up finding yourself getting stuck over and over again, but usually if there's a big enough gap for Davey's body, you can make it through, you just have to be persistent about it. One of the other items I can pick up here is a power-up to my armor that will last for a little bit of time, granting me invulnerability or at least better defense overall. There's also potions you can find as well as other items depending upon what world you're in. For example, you'll use potions in this level in order to refill your health, but you'll use apples in another level. After traveling through the forest for quite a bit, we will actually come to the Dark Knight and have to deal with him. You'll see his health bar in the lower right corner next to ours. Doing the jump spin attack will definitely help you do multiple hits. When he gets to the far right, go one step down and keep doing the attack until he's defeated. He'll drop his lance, and when you pick up, you'll get the next story cutscene before the next level. Level number 2 has us in the Wild West for the first time. Here we will be becoming the sheriff and have to deal with several different bandits. The Wild West levels are different from the other levels in the game. Here you'll actually have to manage your money. You'll have to have a certain amount of items in order to sell to the shop in order to get money to buy your guns and ammo. When we first start off, though, we're going to go to the sheriff's office. We're going to get our salary and our sheriff's badge, as we are now officially the sheriff of this small Wild West town. Then you'll want to go south to the Western Union, where you'll get a telegram basically telling you your mission for this particular part of the Wild West. After we end up leaving there, we're going to head over to the left. Sometimes you'll find items laying on the ground, such as dynamite, which you can use in order to take out enemies, and you'll have to use at certain points as well. We're then going to go to the shop and buy the handgun. We have a little bit of bullets already with us. We're then going to go next door to the blacksmith and do the first duel of the game. With the duels, you can either use the NES Zapper or the regular controller. You want to point down to the lower left corner and fire at where his gun is. You actually can fire before his gun even appears, but as long as you're aiming in that area, you'll defeat him and move on to the next level. Next up is the first of the Ancient Greece levels of the game. Now, our goal in these levels usually are to get certain items like a bow and arrow or even magical sandals to help us jump over. We start off with just our fists to kind of help us battle most of the Roman guard-like guys that are going to be battling us. The Ancient Greece levels are easily the most confusing, with lots of different labyrinths, even more so than the other levels of the game. There's a lot of buildings throughout these levels, some of which will contain items that are important, other times just apples. Even with just the apple, they may give you the hint that you need in order to make it to the next area. For example, here we're going to get ourselves the bow for the first time and use that in order to help us take out enemies. Thankfully, we have an infinite amount of arrows with the bow. One annoying thing about this game, as you probably already noticed, is enemies like to spawn out of nowhere and can be a very big nuisance, draining your health pretty quickly. So always keep an eye on your health and use your apples or potions whenever you do need them. Over here, we're going to head south through this opening and then along the south of the river bend, taking out this guard and grabbing the shield item. If you have nothing already equipped for your item in your B slot, it will automatically equip the shield, and you can use this to deflect items, which becomes a major point of the Roman levels. You'll have to use the shield in order to deflect many different types of projectiles from the different various bosses that we'll be fighting in the Roman levels. Out of all the level types, I think most of the game is spent within the Ancient Greece levels. With the bow and arrow and shield, we're going to work our way back to where we started this whole area, and now work our way over to the left. Once here, watch out for some of these guards taking them out if you want to so they don't bundle up on you, and continue down south to the bridge. Now, you can go down here earlier, but you won't be able to defeat or get past because you don't have the shield to block the projectiles. When you get close to the guy throwing the giant spears at you, block using the shield and you'll reflect one of those lances right back at him to defeat him. Once he has been defeated, go over to the left and enter inside of this building and you'll travel to the next boss fight. For the Cyclops, what you'll have to do is either reflect arrows back at him that he'll fire out, or you have to shoot arrows into his eye when he gives you the opportunity. The opportune time can be difficult sometimes to spot, so it'll take a little bit of practice to get the timing down of when you should actually fire arrows at him. It takes a lot of hits, and he slowly marches his way down towards you, so you don't get a lot of extra time to work with in order to do damage to him and stop him from running into you near the bottom of the screen. If he gets too far down, you can stand still and keep attacking him, but I recommend going as far down first before doing so. Level number 4, we are back in the Middle Ages. Did you miss it already? Now, our goal in the Middle Ages this time is different than the last, but overall it's the same map location, as we'll have to walk through find the next key item, and then work our way to the next boss fight. In this case, we have to work our way to a gold ring located on this large map, and then we actually end up heading back pretty much to where we started, so pretty long trek. Enemies are the same as they were the first time around, use the spin to help you out a little bit. The bird enemies can be quite persistent when they're rolling on down when you're heading upwards. They'll just keep reappearing over and over again. Thankfully, though, they don't do too much damage to you, and once in a while you get lucky to find one of those beautiful hourglasses that will speed you up as well as stop everyone else from moving for a period of time. Once you have the gold ring, the boss for this area will appear. Do the jump spin attacks in order to get past him. I'm not sure if you actually have to take him out, but you'll use the same strategy. When you can get to the right of him, just do one step downwards and then keep spamming the spin move until he goes down himself. Once he is taken care of and we have the gold ring in our possession, start working your way back to the beginning of the area. Like I said, the bird enemies can definitely be a nuisance when you're trying to head upwards as they keep spawning just right in front of you. Sometimes really hard to be able to even hit or dodge them altogether. When you make it up here, you can pass by the guard. Usually he'll drop one of those hourglass items. Head over to the right and go inside this hole located here. You'll teleport right near a sword, grab it in order to complete the area. Next up, we are back in ancient Greece, and when you start up the level, you're going to immediately be attacked by two different enemies. Deal with them the best you can, then go through the opening above. Our goal here is to eventually work our way towards Cerberus in order to battle with the ancient dog of hell. Weirdly enough, go up here near this apple and you'll be teleported, well, to hell, near the River Styx. Walk along here, watching out for fire along the way that'll try to block your path. There's a few different enemies, but overall the path is pretty straightforward. At the end, though, you'll end up running into the ferryman, who will tell you you need coins in order to go along the river, which you don't have yet. And actually, in order to get them, you'll attack a tree right in the first area. This tree right there will end up giving you the coins you need. Now you may say, why not get them the first time? Well, it's one of those great things where it does not appear even if you attack the tree the first time you end up starting the level. So you have to walk through the River Styx, then get the coins, and then go back, and then we'll be able to give the coins to the ferryman. Most people, even if they knew they were looking for an item, would get very upset if they found out that, yeah, they're on the very first screen, but you can't get them until you travel through the area that you need them for. Either way, since we have them, we will end up giving them to the ferryman, and he'll let you know that you're going to need a mighty spear and bow. Now, this area is where things in the game get very obnoxious, as there is a ton of instant death pits set up throughout the ground. When watching me through any of these areas underneath the land of hell, I will sometimes do a weird walking pattern, jumping, heading to the very bottom of the screen, for example, here to walk along in order to get to the spear that we need for the first pickup, the Spear of Mars. When we head back out, you'll walk along the bottom as well. The path that I take is usually pretty specific because going outside this path or not making specific jumps, you will end up being grabbed and pulled down even to, I guess, farther hell, and you'll instantly game over and have to restart the level. You don't have lives in the game. When you end up dying, you start the level over from the beginning. Over here, you'll go through the opening, you'll pop up right on the opposite side. Keep heading over to the right, dealing with some skeletons when you have to. You'll see that the specific path that we take down a little bit, and then around this wall in order to avoid any of those pits. Walk along the river bank a little bit, and then head across another bridge. Here, if we make a jump over to the middle area, we can skip having to deal with a lot of the doors, as we'll find this hat, the Cap of Steel, located. Then we're going to make another jump upwards north in order to get back up here to where that bridge was a second ago. In order to get past here normally, you would walk all the way over to the left and go through several doors in order to get around to the cap and to get back up here. Since we found the Cap of Hades, we'll need that in order to get rid of Cerberus. We also find the bow that we need located here. We now have all the items that we need in order to battle Cerberus. Make sure that you equip the new bow that we picked up. It'll also help you take out some of the enemies like the Reapers that are located here. Walk down here and enter into this area for the Cerberus fight. For Cerberus, walk straight up to the top, stand in front of the far right head, and fire over and over again until you defeat the first head. Then, do the same with the middle and the far left head. If you do it the way I did, you should only take a couple of hits. If you end up getting hit more than that, check your health and make sure you use the apples if you need them. Once he's done, we move on to the next level. For level number 6, we are back in the Middle Ages again. Here our goal is to find the legendary Sword of Excalibur and deal with some bad guys as well. New enemies are introduced, the wizard enemies. These guys will float around and fire fireballs in your direction. These can get quite obnoxious. There's also red knights and I think a few other tweaks to the normal enemies that were here before. The map layout, however, is the exact same as always. In order to find the legendary sword, we're actually going to be going to a whole new area that we haven't traveled to yet. Going across this bridge, we end up in the winter area. How it goes from spring to winter that quickly, I'm not exactly sure, but either way, it's a whole new map to explore. We'll start off by heading all the way down to the south. Once you finally have an opening to the left, take it and work your way all the way up the large middle area. You'll have plenty of area to move around to get past some of the enemies and deal with them, which is thankful. Go through this opening on the right side and walk towards the lake, then up in order to go through this opening. You'll pop out at another part of the same area. Head over to the right, go walk into the lake itself, and you will be granted Excalibur. Once you have it in your hands, go back through the portal that we took to get here and head back through the little opening we took right before going through that portal. You're going to head straight left as far as you can and then head up north to another bridge. Once here, you're going to have to deal with another Dark Knight. For this fight, get up above him all together and then stand here and wait for him to get up as well and start massively attacking. If you're in the right position, you'll be able to hit him multiple times before he'll be able to move up far enough past you in order to do damage to you. Just keep doing your best to stay above him. Don't let him get above you so that he can attack downwards at you. It'll be annoying because it takes a lot of hits sometimes to actually even make contact, but I find this to be probably one of the best strategies in order to be on with the boss. You're basically waiting for an opportunity for him to open up and start attacking so that you can thus attack him. It'll take forever, but when the battle's over, you're given an option for either granting the knight mercy or not mercy. If either way you pick, you'll continue on in the game. However, if you don't pick mercy, you'll pretty much be scolded for doing so. Next up, we're back to the Wild West. Just like before, we're going to go back to the Sheriff's Office. Here, you'll be granted a key that opens pretty much every door in the entire area. Once we have that in our possession, we'll be going back to the Western Union in order to get our mission. Basically, our mission is to stop some bandits from the bank. And what you'll have to do is make sure you have enough ammo in order to deal with the bandits that we're going to be dealing with here. The best and easiest way to do this is actually heading to the right of the screen. You'll be in a different part of the map. Located here on the very far right, you'll come to a building. Once you enter inside the building, you'll find this woman who, well, if you ask her for help, she'll give you an Indian relic. The Indian relic sells for a large amount of money. Take the Indian relic and go to the trading post and sell it, and then use that money that we got in order to buy the ammo and weaponry that we need. There is an exploit in the game though. As many times as you need it, you can go back to her and get another ancient Indian relic. As long as you come back to the trading post and sell it, you can go get another one, and this is the easiest way and most hassle-free way in order to get money in the game. Make sure when you go to the trading post and trade in the Indian relic, you trade in any of the other items you may have picked up. Now, I will also show you a little bit of walking around, defeating some of the random other enemies and snakes in order to pick up a few other things like the snake skins. You can also use them to sell. However, the absolute best way to deal with any of this is by going and getting yourself another Indian relic. So, after defeating a few random enemies, let's make that trek all the way back to that random house to the right and get ourselves another Indian relic. Be careful because sometimes the snake enemies can actually poison you in the game. You'll notice that you're poisoned because your hat will actually turn green, and you'll notice that your health will slowly deplete, so if you're poisoned, definitely keep an eye on it. Just like always, you can use your health items whenever you would like to in order to bring that health back up. With another Indian relic, we're going to come back here and go ahead and sell it. We now have plenty of money. We have $78 to do with what we wish, and we're going to head up in order to go to the ammo store and buy ourselves some weapons. Here, we're going to buy the Winchester 7-shot, the most expensive shotgun in the game, and then buy a crap ton of shotgun ammo with the money that we currently have left. Once we have a large amount, we're then going to now go to the bank and deal with these guys. The reason why you can't just go straight to the bank and take out the enemies with like your whip, it doesn't do any damage. Yep. Your main weapon, the whip weapon, which doesn't require ammo, does zero damage to the bandits that pop out of the bank. Now, dynamite can hurt them, so you have plenty of dynamite, you'd be able to defeat them all, and the handgun does minimum damage, but the best is honestly just sell the Indian relics till you get the shotgun, and use that in order to take out the bandits that pop out. Once you deal with the bandits that are coming out, you'll have to deal with another one of those one-on-one gunfights. Point the gun right at his gun when he's about to fire and take him out. You'll then be informed that you have to go somewhere else now. Once you leave here, you're going to want to go to the blacksmith and you'll have to deal with two bandits back to back. If either one of them shoots you, even if you're taking out the first one, if the second one ends up shooting you, it's still a game over and you'll have to redo the whole stage. These gunfight sequences are very annoying. I've never, of course, tried them with the gun zapper. I've only done it with the D-pad. And getting over to that spot can be tricky. But like I said, the key to it is you can actually fire at that spot before they even pull the gun out. Once you defeat both of them back to back, we move on to the next level. And when we make it to the next level, we're in Greece again. Our goal here is to deal with Medusa. So we're going to be collecting a certain amount of items to help us out. Interesting about this particular level is the fact that we actually, after completing it, will go right to another part of ancient Greece, instead of going back and doing a cutscene and traveling to one of the other areas. By far, the absolute most annoying part of this particular level is being on top of the wall. Here, we'll have to maneuver around, walk around, which doesn't seem too difficult, but it's maze-like and get quite confusing when trying to figure out exactly where you're supposed to go to next. Of course, you'll want to follow the path I do in order to get to where we need to, in order to grab the items we need in order to make it, well, to the next part. The harpies that attack you are great enemies in order to destroy them because they will give you a large amount of apples each time you defeat one, and you can replenish the apple count and then use the apples to refill your health at any point. Stop by here in order to get a powerful shield. Once you have that, start heading back. Like I said, if you're low on health at any time, and it's very easy to get low on health with these enemies, destroy the harpies and grab the apples they drop. That way you'll have plenty of health to be able to be used. When you make it over to here, you'll see this row of columns in the diagonal direction. You'll run ahead south. Once you've gone down, you'll see another building. Ignore it to the left and enter this hole. Once down here, head over to the left and then up, and you'll eventually come across another building. Inside here, though, you will find the magic sandals. The sandals allow you to jump over small gaps, and you must find this item in order to continue. Before heading back up to the wall itself though, head to the left. You'll find some items, usually a gold apple, and you'll be able to find a bag. I think the bag maybe lets you hold more of the items, but I'm not even positive about that. Either way, once you have those items, head back over to the right through the column rows, and head back on top of the wall. Once back on the wall, go up past the diagonal rows of columns we passed earlier and head to the right here. You'll head up north just a little bit and you'll see a little bit of a gap to the right. Use that and you'll be able to float over it since we have the sandals. When you drop down though, it's time to battle Medusa. For the Medusa fights, you can fire at her a lot of times and then reflect her arrows back with her using the shield. When you see her eyes start to glow and flash, hold the shield button. Do not let go of the shield button until her eyes stop flashing. If you end up letting go too soon or don't press it at all, you will be turned to stone and it's a game over there. You'll have to start the level over again. The timing for reflecting the shots back and delivering your own takes a little bit of getting used to, but you'll have plenty of opportunity to do so, because once you defeat that Medusa, well, just a little bit to the right, well, it's another Medusa with the same fight. This one will be a little bit tougher than the previous one. I think it moves a tiny bit quicker, but it's the same concept of reflecting the arrows back at her and making sure you're protecting yourself when she's doing the eye flash move, launching in any of your own arrows when you get the opportunity to do so. Always keep, of course, an eye on your health if you do end up taking hits throughout the fights. And when you reflect, you will have to press the reflect button again after reflecting an arrow. You can only reflect one at a time per button press. So that's something to keep in mind. Once you defeated that Medusa, well, walk to the right, and... yep, no surprise, it's time for another Medusa fight. Thankfully though, this is the final Medusa fight. It's also the toughest. She moves the quickest, she can move up and down pretty rapidly and come at you, unlike the other Medusas that we've been battling with. I guess this is the true, actual Medusa. It'll be a pretty lengthy fight, but once you defeat Medusa, pick up her head and walk to the right. You'll be back outside. Immediately enter the building right next to you. You'll be granted Pandora's Box's key, and then you'll move on to the next part of the level. Like I said, this is the only time a stage transitions right into another stage. This is actually technically Mount Olympus, and here you're going to be fighting Spartans. While we already got a pair of sandals earlier on, those sandals apparently are no good. In order to get a pair of sandals to make other jumps, we need to defeat each of these Spartans. Each time you defeat one, he'll drop another pair of sandals that you'll use to make it over the next gap. This can get tiresome pretty quickly, and the enemies are a pain. You'll have to reflect a lot of the spears back at them in order to defeat each of the guys, and they can drain your health really quickly. Sometimes they just kind of spawn out of nowhere or in hard locations to get in front of in order to reflect those spears right back at them. Always keep an eye on your health though. I like to at least have the 10 apples going into this area. That way, especially here, when the guy kind of appears out of nowhere immediately launching tons of the spears at me, I'll be able to replenish my health. There isn't really anything else to this area, so you'll just keep defeating the guys over and over again using the spears. After enough of them though, you will come to a building which you can enter in order to find Pandora's Box. Here you can open it or close it. Either way, you'll continue, but end up with a different scene. I like to open it for the better scene of seeing the bugs fly everywhere. We are now fully done with Ancient Greece, and we only have two more levels left to go. The Middle Ages one more time, and finally the Wild West one more time. Here in the Middle Ages, our goal is to work our way through, eventually getting the grappling hook in the first area, which is located where the sword was in the first area of the game. You'll use the grappling hook in order to get past the winter area, so once you have the grappling hook, you'll travel all the way back through this area, work your way to the winter area, and then to the new area. Basically, a lot of walking around. We'll be right back. It's a lot of fun traveling through these same areas repeatedly over and over again. Like I said, there are some of the knights around that will give you little hints on basically what you're supposed to do. For example, that one told us about the grappling hook. But sometimes you're just kind of left up to your own devices to try to figure out what you're supposed to do next in the game. Eventually, we finally make it over to the riverbed here on the left side, and after traveling up, we get to the bridge in order to enter into the wonderful Winterland. Once back here, our path that we took the last time around is, well, pretty much the path that we'll be taking, except we don't have to stop by and get Excalibur this time around. We'll start off by heading all the way south, and then walking over to the left through a little bit of an opening, watching out for the enemies as we can, and heading up here. Head up here to where we fought that knight earlier on in the game, and head straight across the bridge. You'll use the grappling hook in order to get to the next area. This weird area is very reminiscent of the hell area that we dealt with in the Ancient Rome stage. Start off by walking along the edges here, going all the way to the left and then down. Just like in the Ancient Rome area in hell, we have to walk specific paths in order to avoid accidentally falling down and getting grabbed into the land below and gaming over. This is extremely frustrating on where you can walk and where you can't walk. Obviously, if you see me walk there, you know you can, but there's really no easy way to know this without some trial and error, at least from what I've noticed. Another thing you'll have to deal with is collecting spears. First, we're going to get a key over here in the lower left that you enter the Great Hall for the next boss fight. We're also going to defeat enemies in order to get spears to use on the dragon. As you can see, I currently have one in my inventory. The red football helmet wearing looking guys, these guys drop spears every time you defeat one. They also appear in some of the same locations, so you can get ones to respawn over and over again, slowly taking them out. While the spears aren't absolutely necessary to defeat the boss, they do more damage than your normal attacks, so you'll want to get as many of them as you can, but it does take quite a lot in order to defeat the upcoming dragon boss. This whole part of grinding some of the enemies to get extra spears is one of the most annoying aspects of the game. Then again, the same thing goes for the money in the Wild West levels unless you do the Indian relic exploit. I'm going to replenish as much of my health as I can before crossing this bridge for the first of the two boss fights. This guy is, well, worse than the other knight type bosses we've been fighting throughout the game. This guy, while he looks similar to the same one we fought before, he can jump. He jumps slowly and lands hard, and if he lands directly on top of you, instant death. So you'll have to avoid him landing directly on you, wait for your opening opportunities when he usually goes for an attack himself in order to deliver attacks. The best way to do this is usually from the side of him or directly behind him. He likes to, however, back up quite a bit in order to try to avoid you hitting him, and you don't want to be too close so that when he backs up, he ends up clipping you with his feet when he does a jump. Nothing's worse than draining this guy's health and then have him accidentally land on you just barely, and with how poor the hit detection is, you don't have to be directly next to him for him to technically land on you. Thank you. Once the battle is over with, head inside the building for the dragon fight. Equip all the spears that you have. Hopefully you have about 20 or so. I only have 13 going in, but I'll still be able to get through. You're going to want to run around and avoid the fireballs that the dragon spits out while delivering your spear throws. Don't just mash the spear throws. You need to wait for the opportunities. Throw one and then wait a few seconds to throw the next. Then, once you're out of spears, do your jumping attack. Do this in order to slowly do damage to the dragon, watching out for direct fire from his fireballs. He'll spam more and more usually when he's getting low on health, but just keep jumping and attacking in order to hit him. He has quite a bit of health. He'll start to flash, thankfully, when he is getting low on health, and this is definitely the hardest fight in the entire game. Once he's defeated, though, we can pick up the gauntlet here and move on to the final level of the game. The final stage of Daydreamin Davey is another Wild West sequence. Just like before, we're going to stop by the sheriff's office in order to get our money, and then we're going to go by the Western Union in order to get our mission. I don't know if you have to stop by the Western Union, but it comes force of habit, and I've always done it at the beginning of each Wild West area. Thankfully, though, we do have a decent amount of money already. We're going to go to the left, and you need to stop inside here in order to get a key that we need for an area we're going to be traveling to. Once we have that key in our possession, you want to head up north and go inside of the gunsmith's area in order to buy as much of the ammo that you possibly can afford. Some of the other things you can buy here include the dynamite as well as a different hat, which I think is technically more defense. Buy as much ammo. Use all the money you have left in order to fill up as much ammo, because this is the last time we're going to need ammo. Then from there, you're going to want to head north. You'll do a jump over this fence. You can only do it at the actual gate of the fence, and you'll appear in a new area once going through the hole. Once here, go to the left to enter another hole, and guess what? You're at the River Styx. Yeah, for some reason you end up at the River Styx area. Well, the same exact looking area. Though, I guess maybe we are here, maybe we aren't. I don't even know what he's thinking anymore. Either way, you'll make it to the end and you'll find Hades. Yep, you end up finding Hades during the Wild West stage. Either way, you'll pop out into a graveyard and you'll want to walk right to the funeral home. Entering inside here, well, you'll pop out in a whole new area. From here, go over to the Union Market, where you'll have to deal with guys that pop out of here, similar to the bank earlier on in the previous Wild West stage. You'll have to fight several of these guys back to back, so make sure you have plenty of ammo, then go inside the Union Market and deal with one of those cowboys. Once he's defeated, you'll be told about the Harwood House. Then go north and you're going to enter a building up here, and then you're going to fight three of the cowboys back to back to back. This is where firing where their gun is going to be is the key. If the gun pops up, you're already dead and you're going to have to start over, especially with the third guy. But once he's defeated, you can sit back and enjoy the ending. Davey. To Daydreaming Davey.
I'm out of here.
So there you have the ending to Day Dreaming Davey. Then you'll see Davey in his various forms and some of the various enemies that we've been battling throughout, as well as the credit scroll at the top. Day Dreaming Davey, by far not one of the worst NES games. It isn't. Its cryptic nature, its poor hit detection at times, and honestly, its lack of variety at moments. Being a game with the daydreaming sequences, going through the different areas of the Middle Ages, Rome, and the Wild West is very cool at first, and then gets tedious when you're going to the same areas over and over again. If it wasn't for the instant death areas of the Hell areas, this game would definitely be a lot better in my opinion. Also, with the Wild West gun-slinging sequences, for a long time I wasn't even sure if it was possible to win until I found out you could shoot where the gun will eventually be and not wait for the gun to be drawn. Without knowing that, I may never have beaten this game. But with that, guys, that's going to wrap up this edition of Play It Through. I'd like to thank you for watching, and of course, I hope you enjoyed.